I've interviewed. Do you hear me? I'm not very used to using this kind of a microphone, so I'm a little bit unprepared, to be honest, because I started organizing the whole thing like 3 hours ago, and then I realized there is a lot of material and little time to organize it in a sensible manner. So I thought I'll maybe do like a first part of it right now, like give an overview. And I'm doing like maybe a small session later, which will be more whiteboard and like a more participatory discussion between all of us or people who are interested to take a deeper look at the topic. So so if you're interested to continue with it after the overview, then we can meet later with the whiteboard in a corner in a circle of chairs where we can talk to each other. I wanted to tell you a little bit about why I came to talk about this topic. It is, well, I live in Berlin, and a couple years ago, a couple of my best friends got like swallowed by the Pride project, so they were constantly talking about Pride Week and doing stuff about Pride Week and bugging other people to join Pride Week. So it was like a really present topic back there. And due to that, I've only done some stuff with Pride Week. Like, I was on a church or two, bringing poles and hanging around routers and stuff. And I flashed the router or two of my own, and I also translated the Pride Week word information to English. So if you kind of look at it and you don't understand German, maybe it's my incoherent English also, which over there. However, I'm not really, really active in the community. I'm not going to any meetings and stuff. A couple of months ago, I needed to do a research project for university about a seminar called Software Engineering, or recent topics in software engineering or something like that. And I was thinking, oh, maybe it would be cool to do something with Pride Week. The topic I came up with was to compare what motivates people to do Pride Week compared to what motivates people to engage in free and open source software projects. And today I'll be giving more the five-point focus of all this. It's like, well, when I started working on that, I read like a couple of motivation papers on free and open source software. And there are some works, some papers on community networks, but none of them actually focuses on motivation or why people do this. So what I did was I just went out there and asked some people why they do Pride Week. And it started at the 22C3 at the Congress in December. So these are, I'm giving an overview of all the people I asked in a second. So these were the people who are not from Berlin, basically. And then I also asked a couple of people in Berlin. So I'm giving now an overview over the what the people asked for this, and then I'll tell you something about the structure of the whole thing. Okay, so I've asked some people in total, according to my perceptions, because I didn't ask them, two of them were females and 14 were male. This is how long the people have been participating in the project. There are 7 people who joined like recently in the last 2 years, 5 people have been working with approximately for 3 years now. One person was there for almost 4 years, between 2004 and 2008. And 3 people who are in Pride Week for more than 8 years. This is the overview where they came from. 9 of them are from Berlin, 3 from Rheinland, 1 from Brüssel, 1 from Berlin, 1 from Bielefeld, and 1 from Hamburg. And I would maybe like in some future to compare motivation in the Freiburg project with motivation in other community networks projects. Because I guess there are some key characteristics of every project which are different between countries and between projects, so I guess that things that are bad for Freiburg will be less bad for PPE or for aluminium or needle, so or whatever. Yeah, so it would be cool to talk to some other people. If you are quiet later, just come say hi. Yeah. So basically, what I did was I developed a questionnaire on my own, which was probably not the most sophisticated questions which you can ask, and a little bit repetitive and stuff. And it consisted of one general part where people talk to me about what is cool about the project, why they like it, what they don't like about it, why they do it and stuff, and one more specific part where I ask my control questions, like for example, is money playing a role for you in your engagement, or is learning new stuff about networks playing a role? And so I decided to organize this this presentation around these two parts, and I would like to start with the general part, so I will just give you some quotes basically from what people told me, which are already organized
according to
the topics which came up.
So move it.
And then in the second part, I wanted to go through the specific questions and maybe organize them on a scale of what are different types of motivation according to some psychological research. But I wanted to do this with a whiteboard and like more in a conversation, so I don't feel comfortable with the space here to do that. So I will start with general part, and if you want to do the more specific part, we're talking and organize on an axis later, then we can do this like later or more or something. Yeah. Okay. So I need to switch slides briefly. I always say I talk to the people in German, so everything which comes right now is like my translation of what people told me in German into English, so if there's some inaccurate stuff and errors, it's my fault, and I sorry to all the people who talked to me and maybe said something which was slightly something else, and I ended up translating it in a super final. Why I decided to participate in Freiburg? So these are some of the answers people gave. I like the idea of connecting people in a decentralized, non-commercial manner. It's a challenging idea to radio with each other, to do things with the network, to connect people in the neighborhood, to do community-based work, not only in the internet, but also in the physical world. It was the refugee context. I found it important to provide a communication infrastructure to people who don't have one. I founded it, and there was no usable internet in Friedrichshain, which is a neighborhood in Berlin, in the year 2003, so I needed to take stuff in my hands. The intersection of community and technique is intriguing. Or around this time, welfare started, which was about 2003, the legal regulations in Germany have just changed. So it was at once possible to free deploy Wi-Fi networks and to play around with them. What's cool about the project? What's the primary motivation of the people? There are some answers which clustered around the concepts of community work or around the project, which was stuff like, from the today's perspective, it's cool how big it has become. I learned a lot about how communities work and how they don't work, how much structure is helpful and how much structure is not helpful, what volunteer work means, what tasks get and not, and why, what should be decided at all costs, who decides that, and stuff like that. Basically, how community volunteering projects are organized. And then there were some answers grouped around the idea of free infrastructure, which were, for example, there is a right to free communication and information, free decentralized communication infrastructure built and managed by the people who use it and not by the state or business players. I wanted to have an independent network which cannot be switched off by a single person. And some like decentralized infrastructure is good, but it also makes things difficult. Then again, some other answers grouped around the idea of providing access to internet to people who don't have such. Answers were there was no usable internet in Friedrichshain, the Berlin neighborhood in 2003. I want to share my own internet connection with people who need it, which today is primarily the whole refugee context. Then some other answers were grouped around the idea that fighting has an educational mandate. This is or at least I perceive it as such, and it is like one of the main goals which is stated by the website, that Frightening is about sharing knowledge and learning from each other, so some of the answers were grouped around that, not far as many as I expected after reading the website, but one of the people mentioned
this. Which website?
I think this was the Frightening by Me website.
Okay, so offer specific.
I'm not pretty familiar, it was source somewhere where it had that, but from but I perceive this as a role of the whole community, let's say, throughout Germany. Okay, so the answers related to the educational mandate were a lot of people have learned about a lot about IT infrastructure in this context. So the project is cool because of that. What motivated me was education, to educate people about what's a computer network, how does it work, how secure it is, and stuff like that. Then there are some people, and these were the majority actually, most of the people talked about this aspect is that they really think it's the community feeling or the social part of the project is cool. And they said the community or the people are cool. I've grown to love the community, not only in Hamburg, I think it was, but the whole faculty community. The social interconnectedness is cool. The international contacts were made, somebody talked about, we organized like a little bit of solid conferences where we invited international experts, and so suddenly it was a big deal and we got to travel around the world because of community networks. It's quite fun. Like, for example, here now. One gets to know interesting and different people and comes out of one's comfort zone and out of one's social bubble, so it's like a place where different people meet. Um, The whole project is technically interesting or challenging. One person talked about stuff you can physically touch when you engage in a community network project, so it's more tangible compared to coding, and this makes you happy, apparently. Also, people tell this school to climb on church towers and look at the city from above or look on the inside of the church towers. And one person said it's technically challenging, despite the fact that he or she, I don't remember, abandoned the idea that it couldn't be an ability to do a last mile German telecom, like connecting your home to the last retail section, whatever it's called. Also, people mentioned that the aspect of growing the own technical know-how. One person said they learned a lot about network technique, and there was scarcely another free time project where you can learn so much about it. Outside of work, let's say. Then people mentioned the feeling that their work is needed and valued as an incentive to engage in the project. They said it's cool when to have the feeling that people need you. You can see that if people use the project, like refugees or students who gather it, at a bus stop in front of the home of one of the participants who had installed present group routers, and there was a lot of positive feedback. So these were basically the separate aspects which people classify as cool or as motivational for them to continue participating in the project. And then they also mentioned a couple of points which they found were not so cool. So there was this idea that sharing knowledge gets neglected, although it's like one goal, let's say, of the community, according to people or to the website. So one person said that sharing knowledge is not as focused as it should be, or that there are still knowledge hierarchies, and that people at the end of the day are not really glad to work without hierarchies, so do not feel comfortable with like a horizontal flat structure, and hierarchies, also knowledge hierarchies, tend to feel themselves quite automatically when you cannot or don't do anything to counteract that. Then, it's a nice quote as well. It's definitely so much ego screaming for attention altogether. So, this is why sharing knowledge is difficult in the end, because people like to get the attention. Another aspect which people found not so cool was the communication or discussion culture in the community. They said working in a team is often quite difficult. It's difficult when people think they found the way to sell something and try to push it onto everybody else and seize the control. Sometimes there are like battles between single persons who think they found the way, so it tends to pull the whole project down because there is about like some personal conflict on the project at the end. Then a lot of people also complain that meetings with a lot of talking and no actions are annoying, so a lot of people, you know, this by the end. So a lot of people told me they ended up not going to meetings because nothing really sensible happens there anyway.
They just like to argue.
Yeah, they just want to talk. Yeah, so I guess this is not a preference, this is a problem with the Then people also mentioned the gender aspect, that they found conflict. Unfortunately, the community has probably abandoned. It's kind of difficult to open up and engage anymore abroad. People with broader backgrounds. It's also difficult to communicate the idea what it is the project about. People said it's difficult to convey the topic of information self-determination to people outside the community. And this aspect is only starting to get more present in the current refugee context, at least in Germany apparently, that more people like get sensitive or worried about what it's all about, or that it really is important to have connections to the internet and the possibility to communicate with others and to receive information. Apparently the users with service mentality only complain when stuff doesn't work and do not actively try to do something about it, so they haven't got the idea according to the participants. I asked them who told me that Pridecon is about engaging and doing the stuff yourself and not about providing services to people. And there are also some technical limitations, like unfortunately the political idea is not really scaling technically, that the idea of this decentralized free infrastructure, which is in the hand of the community and stuff, is like really cool, but if you try to make it bigger, it's not really working, because at some point you need to get connected to the internet or to the next community, and it stops working at some point, maybe. As I mentioned, was also that the whole project depends too much on the effort of single people, and only few people really understand how it works and are able to manage it. So the whole project ends up like dependent on these very few people and who are responsible about everything and who are also overloaded. So it's again about this hierarchy thing that's unfortunately not really working. Also somebody said that it's only gets really technically interesting if the network grows and you have a big network. However, at this point, if you have a big network, you attract the service mentality users who are there for the internet and not for playing with the net. So the people who enjoy experimenting and enjoy developing stuff, they get scared away because there are all the people complaining, oh, it's not working, can't fix it. And you're feeling like you're the help desk from your job, you do that's the right way to start. So I think these were the negative aspects, yes. This is the end of them. And we still got like half an hour, so I guess you have some questions or not, or comments or whatever. Yes. And I don't know, maybe you can as well because nobody will hear you.
More than a question is more something like a comment. First of all, I want to tell you that Pridecon is really, I'm from Colombia, from Bogota.
Yeah.
I'm running with my colleague Oscar from the Codename from Bogota. Pridecon is one of the first projects we get information and was one of the first that we tried not to emulate but to follow the experience. So it's really rewarding to share experience with someone who belongs to Pridecon. Because it was really interesting. And the comment is that those aspects that you told us, I think they happen in most of the communities. We are facing the same issues in Bogota. In Bogota, there were also other projects that eBay was disintegrated for those issues. My comment is, keep going, because I think we are going it really good. Of course, there are some stuff that we must overcome in order to get the project more dynamic, more interesting, but there are many positive stuff. For example, I have changed many emails with a lot of people, and they were like, hey, do this, like this, this is a solution by this. So, that is the comment, something really interesting, more than the question. Or maybe I can find out a question, and it's, how do you Germans feel or think when someone from an outside community asks you a question about mesh networking or mesh community force or something like that? Because I have asked community many questions and I got mixed questions. So the question is like, how do you perceive when someone from another place reaches you for a question?
I really think I'm the wrong person to answer that.
Why?
Well, because I'm really not an advocate. Maybe you can pass my computer off. It's a old problem.
Okay, no problem. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I think of course it's great if somebody has an idea and asks questions about the project and what we did or want to do and what works from our point of view and what not. And I think it's great if you ask some questions. Also shows that there's some interest in our project and keeps us going.
So it was interesting to see the graph about the gender gap. I think most of the communities have the same gap or even more. According to you, Kaufman, why is that? Why do women not participate? Is it because they lack of interest? Is it because they are scared by so many men, or why do you think? Do you have an idea, or can you give us some suggestions on how to improve this?
Well, I'm not really sure, but I've had a feeling at first, I didn't show you that, but I also asked people what their background is, like, do they come from like technical professions, so what they do, what other stuff they do apart from let's say, and all the people were like engineers of some sort. Some of them were still at school, some of them were working, but all of them were computer science people, let's say.
Nerds.
Yes, yeah. And I guess, at least in Germany, so, and I think it's changing, but it's still so that there's the same gender gap as there are in universities, right? So in technical professions, there are like really few women. And, maybe it's a false perception that Kaufman is really only open or you can really only participate in a valid manner if you're some tech nerd person. But the perception is there, I think. I've got a perception as well myself. And as long as it's like has the feeling or the flair of only be open or to people with like technical backgrounds, and people with technical background are men primarily, right? So you will only get them. So I guess it's like if the whole project tries to broaden its perspectives or to say, hey, okay, look here, there are some perspectives which are not quite the technical or practical, isn't only about sitting there and doing stuff on firmware, right? It's about talking to people, about giving them routers for this firmware, about letting them what's the idea, why it's cool, and stuff like that. So basically, everybody can do this, right? Which who likes the political idea behind it. It's not that you really need the technical know-how for doing every single aspect of the project. But yeah, these are my guesses. What's that? It's unfortunate.
I just wonder what your next steps would be, continuing with the work. It's great work, it's really important.
Yeah, do you mean right now here or like generally? Yeah, well, here I wanted to, if you all would like to do the placement on the whiteboard stuff with people after that, that would be cool. And generally, I don't know, I was thinking about maybe doing like my master's thesis on this kind of making very small projects, like not only Python, because I think it's like a really interesting part of the way you compare, I don't know, Python with network code, with Linux, with Giphy, with whatever. Yeah, but I'm not really sure still, and I don't have like the theoretical background right now for how, what is the sensible way to ask questions in a manner that you really receive answers which are related in some way or another. Yes.
What is the criteria to be which makes a community mesh network as opposed to just a mesh network? Because of course, like every network is run by some community, it could be a commercial entity, obviously, but it's still a community. Is it the aspect of self-administration or the lack of commercialization? Or did it fall in any industry? Because just across Europe, for example, in the Czech Republic, it's a very commercialized, very businessy kind of thing which uses assigned technical tools to achieve something very similar, but coming from a very different motivational background. I think the contrast of Czech Republic to Germany is probably the highest.
Yes, yeah, you're quite right. I think I haven't thought about this much. I think like implicitly for me it was like more this self-organized this type of community, like grassroots movement. But you quite right about you mentioned the network in the Czech Republic, for example.
Also Slovenia.
But I guess it would be interesting to compare them as well, right? To the other projects. So for comparison's sake, I think you could compare all of them and see why what comes out of it and other people are out of different motivation.
Have the community crisis.
Somebody else wants to say something?
Hi. When you say that you were like going to a meeting to write from, but at some point you stopped going. Could be?
That was not me, it was somebody else. I went to maybe 3 minutes altogether, by the way.
No.
I think that was a call from somebody else.
I mean, let's see. If all these people are girls or women, and I'm a boy, I will be like, okay, I mean, you are born have to, because I see a presentation in Chaos Computer Club that say that women need space, need groups, no? Need to, so we have to interact, but also we have to preserve or spaces, because it's difficult when you arrive to a place and you are a unique man or a unique woman to start interacting. And I engage with the same problems, obviously. And I try to work on that, but what I see is that women that try to come to one or two meetings, but after that, it's like they don't want to identify this situation. No, it's like okay, you mean so you are the size. It could be if majority is man win. If majority is woman win. But it's difficult not to maintain this mix. And I don't know if you have something to add about this. For me, it would be difficult.
Yeah. I'm not really, the thing is, I think it could be quite illuminating, right? When you enter a room and there's another woman there, and then you feel sometimes like the kind of political mandate or responsibility to stay there so that other women can come, or like, because, or you like speak to all women at some point, but because you're the only woman there, right? So, which is quite a crowd as well, right now, for example. Which is kind of crowded, but I can't see for so I don't really know. I guess if there's like more balanced group, it's like always much, much easier, right? For people to not feel alienated, or more mixed group, right? So all kinds of people feel welcome. I actually don't really care like the recipe for, here, this is the way where we can be more welcoming to all sorts of people. I guess it's like some first steps which are quite intuitive, let's say, just to say hello to people, show them around, ask them how they got there, tell them who you are, stuff like that, so that there is some kind of a feeling of, oh, I'm welcome. Kind of a safer space where I don't feel like the dumb person because I'm new, I don't know what's so about, right? So it's just like some intuitive stuff you can apply to everything, basically. Let's say. Maybe you would want to say something else. I was just thinking about maybe the particular discussion maybe in order to not to lose a challenge, I will be thinking of a slot, or just come to me and talk to me if you're interested, and then we can think of a slot together and write it on the board or something so that other people can come as well. And then if somebody else wants to say something, then you're welcome. If not, then we can do a break for someone.
Which could also be forwarded to the extended meeting, because I was wondering, as the different communities from an organizational point of view are very diverse, also inside the Reichhold map, you have very organized and also like they create a non-profit organization and have like the chair people or individual structures you find in this type of organizations. And have very loose communities which don't have real technical agreements. It's more like a loose intaking of each other, so it just keeps working to some degree, but with a lot of variation and also a lot of meetings. So my thought now was like, okay, so if you're going to a private meeting or even on the CCC Congress, you would actually mostly meet those which are organized. And there's not so many people who are just not organized at all, because it's also, to see violence in organizations, this is also why I was wondering about your statement regarding the educational goal, because that's a goal of the media organization. Kind of, there's an organization to encourage violence, which doesn't do it themselves, obviously, but it's more like an organization for the encouragement and education about it. It's more like a meta level where you find out, but not so much on a grassroots thing. It's groups of friends sometimes, but it's I guess it's hard to reach.
But as I said, I wasn't quite sure.
The question is: did you ask people whether they're in organized groups? I can't remember the list of cities, and also I don't know about every city, obviously. Like the degree of organization influences the motivation. So Bern and Rheinland are both very differently but very organized. The other cities, I don't really know, Hamburg, it's got through a very big renewal, it's kind of reinvented itself lately. But besides that, I don't know.
Just quick answer to that. I haven't really done the correlation. I guess you're right, it could be quite a good idea to do this. I think actually both the people who talked to me about the educational aspect and who told me the support for them came from Berlin.
Mm-hmm.
But according to my perception, for example, the all that were actually quite connected. I'm not really sure about the video things. And the one person from Berlin sounded like he's doing the solution on his own or something. That was like more. And yeah, the person from Hanover was also more like doing it in his own context or something like that. It's more not going to meetings or something, but doing like hanging in the room, but actively connecting stuff, right? Yeah. Yeah, but I guess you're right, it plays a role. Yeah. I don't have any questions. Where? Yeah, okay, then I'm calling the break and we can meet afterwards.